The point is the heart is a big thing. It's that seat of emotion. It's the affection. It's the place of affection. It's a place of values that are established from this place of the human heart, where what we do with our life is determined in that place. I believe that command to pray without ceasing is the key to heart health. Heart health. How important is that? Jesus dealt with the heart in many different ways. He says, adulteries, jealousies, all these things come from the heart. And he brings this as a word of correction. Then he also says, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So he deals with both ends of the spectrum. The point is the heart is a big thing. It's that seat of emotion. It's the affection. It's the place of affection. It's a place of values that are established from this place of the human heart, where what we do with our life is determined in that place. In Proverbs 4, verse 23 says, watch over your heart with all diligence, because from it flow the issues of life. The issues, all the issues of life. You have a family, you have a job, you've got your own personal health, you've got all these things going on. We've all got a million plates spinning on sticks, you know, and all these issues of life, watching over this one thing. It's like having one idiot gauge on your dashboard. You just watch this one thing, and it's what helps to keep everything else functioning. This one gauge, make sure you've got gas, your oil's right, oil pressure's right, water, everything is correct when you watch this one thing. And that is the significance of this one command in Proverbs 4:23. Watch over your heart with all diligence. I've told you before, it's the way we raised our children. Our discipline was based on heart, is on attitude. If we could correct something when it was in attitude form, we could prevent bad conduct. And it's the same with us. I've invited my wife on many occasions, honey, you know, all I want to do is please Jesus. That's all I want to do. If you see I'm careless with my speech or my attitudes, any of those things, I'm not just giving you permission. I'm inviting you, please point it out to me. I'm determined to recognize and to repent any of those things that happen, but I invite you, please point it out to me, because I don't want that in my life. Watch over your heart with all diligence. Put extra effort in this one thing. Why? Because everything, it affects every single area of your life. So here's what I believe to be the command of the Lord that keeps us in the place of great strength as it pertains to our heart. You know, what do we want? The adulteries and envies and jealousies from the heart, or the pure in heart who see God? This is obviously what we want. So he says this. He says, pray without ceasing. In other words, view prayer as your ongoing primary occupation. If you're an evangelist, you can only evangelize so much during the day. If you pray for the sick, you can only pray for the sick so much. If you're a school teacher, you're only in the classroom so long. But pray without ceasing. I have found that when I create a momentum throughout my day, I actually wake up in the night praying. And one of the things that's important for us to recognize is we don't know what we're doing with prayer. Anybody on this side would agree with me. We don't really know what we're doing. That's why the Bible says we don't know how to pray as we ought. That's the Bible. So it's best to put your bet with the Bible. The Bible says you don't know what you're doing. But here's the cool thing. In Romans chapter 8, it says the Holy Spirit intercedes for us. A few verses later, it says, Jesus intercedes for us. My uncle pointed this out to me a bunch of years ago. Holy Spirit intercedes for me. Jesus is interceding for me. And right in the middle of those two verses is the statement, all things work together for good. I wonder why all things work together for good. I've got the Holy Spirit. I've got the Son of God. They're both pleading my case before the Father. I may not know what I'm doing, but the Holy Spirit who lives in me knows exactly what he's doing. And many people pray enough to ease their conscience, but not enough to change any circumstances, not enough to make a difference. And prayer is the full-time responsibility of the believer. It's not just that time in the morning when you get on your knees and you've got your Bible open. Those are wonderful, but it's more than that. It's the fact that I'll drive down the road, I'll see a car go by that reminds me of a friend I went to school with. I just take that as a sign to pray for them. It's just an automatic reminder. I'll remember a conflict, a conversation I had that was very challenging for me. That'll come to mind. I'll be driving down the street, it'll come to mind. And as soon as it comes to mind, within moments, I will say, I lay down my right to be offended at that. And I pray now for my friend that you would so touch his life or whatever it might be. But the point is we have a full-time occupation of interacting with God. Now, here's the deal. I would like in the next couple minutes, if I could somehow paint a picture for you of the heart of what I believe is the heart of the Father. I believe that the Father wants the earth to be filled with the fruitfulness of the fruitfulness in answer to your prayers. In other words, you were designed to meet with the creator of all, the life giver, to meet with him and to make petition and request, to make decrees and proclamations. And as a result, see the course of history changed and the answers of God sprinkled all over the earth, that there is to be a fruitfulness. I don't think it's yet come to our heart and mind how much God looks for fruitfulness. He looks for increase. He looks for increase in the simplest thing. You know, the talents, you know. They use the talents and the minas, they use the minas, got 10 more. The guy who didn't use it, buried it. The landowner says, why didn't you put it in a bank? At least you would have got interest. In other words, I'm looking for increase. God's not going to give you insights for prayer to increase your knowledge. The insights for prayer is to make you more fruitful. God's not going to give us insights for prayer so that we can write a book about prayer. It's to make us fruitful, so that the earth would be filled with the fruitfulness of the answers to prayer of the saints. That this situation, it was impossible, and Jesus changed it. This family, they were so destroyed, they could never recover, but the mercy of God came, and they've been healed. This business was past being lost, and God raised it up again. Home after home, situation after situation. Why? Because somebody who loves a father is willing to pray until he shows how to pray. I think the fruitfulness that God wants for us from prayer is on the other side of us laying down our offense for so many things not being answered. Prayer is an engagement with a person where we are changed. That's the whole point. If I take an hour to pray, I don't leave that hour changed, then I wasn't praying, I was complaining. It's an engagement with a person. Why? Because I am learning to think like him. How many know you can pray the same prayer 1,000 times, have nothing happen, and you pray it 1,001, and a breakthrough takes place. It's that moment where Jesus says, throw the net to the other side. Do it again. I know you did it all night, but do it one more time. Sometimes it's that one more time of doing the right thing, but this time you did it in the presence. This time we did it in the command of the Lord. This time his hand was on my hand, making the what we were doing effective and powerful. That's prayer. It's the invitation of God to come into a place where we actually make a difference in the course of history because we pray. So here it is. Rejoice always. Pray and don't stop. In everything, give thanks. Emotional, mental health, heart health. And the pure in heart will see God.